Okay, so welcome to this HOVOIS Visiting Fellows Lecture Series. Today I'm very happy to introduce the speakers, Professor Eugene Tishnikov. It's difficult to pronounce his name correctly, but if you separate the vowel, then you should be able to pronounce it correctly. Well, I know Eugene for more than like 30 years old. We know each other for quite a long time because we started doing linear algebra, especially with this matrices. But let me formally introduce you. Professor Eugene Tishnikov is an academician of the Russian Academy of Sciences. He is also the director of the Mashchuk Institute of Numerical Mathematics of the Russian Academy of Sciences in 2010. And he is also a professor and chairman at the Faculty of Computer Science at Moscow State University, where he graduated in 1977. And he has been working at the university since 1980. In 2016, he was awarded the best MSU professor title. His research field include linear algebra and its applications, matrix and tensor computations, asymptotic analysis of matrix sequences, integral equations of mathematical physics, and computational methods. He is the editor-in-chief of Journal of Computational Mathematics and Mathematical Physics, and he's a member of board of several international journals. He has published 6 books and more than 130 scientific articles. So today, Eugene will talk about in search of correct setting for improved problems.
Thank you, Raymond. Should I use this or not? For recording purposes. Okay. I think I'm enough loud. So I'm always happy to be in Hong Kong in CTU. In CTU, it's my second visit also. Today, it will be, of course, it is a scientific talk. I would like to share with you some new mathematical findings, but as well, it will be a kind of philosophical talk. You'll see. What do I mean by that? I will not talk about tensor decomposition, the field where I'm still working. It is a different topic. It is a different topic. For me, this topic has special importance. When I was a PhD student, I learned among other subjects, I learned about the theory of regularization, which provided us with a general approach to solve impulse problems, some general method of doing that. But then it's interesting that your original problem has an unstable solution. So the solution that may change whatever large with whatever small perturbations of data. And anyway, we say that we want to have the object, which is the solution of that bad problem, impulse problem. And then the regularization theory suggests you some tools. But I was not very much satisfied with this situation, because I saw that something strange is going on. But anyway, a lot of people are engaged in doing regularization, still are. Now, let me give you more detail. I begin very smoothly. is something that everybody knows. We consider a problem from linear algebra. So we have an equation, Ax equals b, A is a matrix, A is a matrix, B, maybe it's better, B is a vector, a matrix can be rectangular, and we all know that this system may have no solution, they may have just one solution, and it may have many solutions, infinite many solutions. Even in the case when the system has no solution, we may define a kind of generalized solution. For example, in the least square sets, we may consider the residual b minus ax using some norm. Let's consider Frobenius norm or Euclidean norm in the beginning. Then minimizing this norm, you obtain some vector which will be called, it is usually called pseudo solution. Pseudo solution gives you the minimal possible norm of the residual. There are many such vectors. Yes. But to define just one single vector, just one single pseudo solution, we may say, let's consider such a pseudo solution that is of minimal length. This pseudo solution is called normal pseudo solution. It exists unique and is fully defined by this condition. It is geometrically evident. So this orthogonality condition means that Pythagorean's theorem. This means that among the pseudo solutions, we take the minimal length. So these two conditions define the normal pseudo solution. Moreover, we may remember about the famous SVD, pseudo related decomposition. Then this is the formula that gives you the normal pseudo solution. Exactly. Nice form. So now look, everything looks fine. This normal pseudo solution exists, unique, and even can be obtained by this nice form. Now, this is a good news. Now, a bad news follows. Let us consider a very special system. Just one unknown and one equation. One unknown is x. The matrix consists of one number, epsilon. The right-hand side is one number. If epsilon is equal to zero, let's find the normal pseudo solution. Because the residual doesn't change. The minimal length is, of course, zero. So, this is awesome. If epsilon was not zero, it's obvious that the normal pseudo solution coincides with the solution. It is like this. So, now let us look at the difference. Epsilon minus zero, zero tends to infinity. When epsilon tends to zero, and this is terrible. This means that the normal pseudo solution doesn't depend continuously on the matrix value. So it is a bad object. But anyway, we have the famous method of regularization. The ideology of the method, let me spend some time on this. We have suppose we have an unknown system, AX equals B. So we don't know A, we don't know B, but we talk about this unknown system. And we are asked to find the normal figure solution of this unknown system. But instead of A and B, we are given some A epsilon and B epsilon. So we know this. And so using what we know, we need to produce some approximation to the normal solution of the unknown system. And here, the method of degeneralization in its general form, suggested by Tikhonov, but I believe also some other people, some other names can be mentioned. But anyway, Tikhonov degeneralization method. We symmetrize the system, so we multiply our A epsilon conjugate. We add some idea, the identity matrix is a positive alpha, alpha is a positive number. This is the right hand side. So it's an elementary linear algebra to understand that this matrix is a Hermitian positive definite matrix for any positive alpha. So this system has a unique solution, no problem. So as far as we know, A epsilon, let's choose some positive alpha and solve this system. By the way, let me mention what we are prohibited to do. If we have this data, we should not try to find the normal pseudo solution of this system. We can do this. But if we find the normal pseudo solution of this system, we know that it can be any, it may have nothing in common with the normal pseudo solution. So we should do something different. Suggestion is to take the positive alpha, find solution of this regularized system. Now we have a theory. In principle, all what is going on in theory of regularization is obtaining the results like this. We need some assumption, so nothing comes from it. Assume that A epsilon is not very far from A. Here, epsilon and C zero is a constant that doesn't depend on epsilon. And the same, let's assume the same about the right hand side. And then we have it. If we take alpha equal to square root of epsilon, if we have this, then we can prove such an instance. With a constant C, that doesn't depend upon epsilon, but C depends, of course, C depends on the unknown system, which is not known to us. But anyway, this is the basic result of the theory of regularization. This theorem can be quite easily proved, for example, by using the singular value decomposition. Line, maybe 3, 4, 5 lines, it's not so difficult. So this is the contents of the regularization theory. But now I can show you my question. The question that I had when I was a PhD student. Does it make sense to calculate an object that may arbitrarily change after whatever small perturbation of input data? So the theory of regularization tells us that we can find the approximation to the normal solution of the unknown system But let's ask ourselves why we are interested to do that. A way out. It seems natural to try attracting and exploiting some additional information and reformulate the very problem, converting it into a correct task. It looks very natural. It looks very natural. Not to imply the general method of regularization, but before, try to understand more about your original problem and try to reformulate it so that the new problem becomes a correct problem. But then a natural thing is, now we have a correct problem and let's consider methods and algorithms to solve this. So it seems natural, but nobody goes this way. Anyway, when I was finishing my PhD study, it was 1980, I attended to some lectures by Tikhonov, who presented some of his findings at the time. And I've got an impression at that time, I've got an impression that he was thinking about this very question. Is it just a minute before? In his lectures, Tikhonov suggested a certain reformulation. Like this. The input data is a consistent class of system equivalent on the small perturbation. So we have some individual systems. We are given this individual system. And we are given two numbers, mu and delta. And we consider all systems in the vicinity of a zero to be zero. All systems. In fact, we consider the ball of systems, some ball of systems, neighborhood of one individual system. And then we assume, Tikhonov made an assumption. Let's assume that among the system, there exists a consistent one. So the system that has a classic solution. It must be in the class. Of course, if one is there, then many consistent systems are there. It is an important assumption. Then, what is the out? A minimum Zenz vector among the solutions. So let's consider in this class, we consider all systems that have a classic solution. And among these classic solutions, we choose a solution of minimum. So this was exactly the suggestion of Tikhonov. Looks very natural. I suggest now to call this solution Tikhonov solution. Let's call it Tikhonov solution. Simplicity. And Tikhonov proved in this way. He proved that in the Frobenius norm, he used only the Frobenius. Tikhonov solution exists and unique. Well, now after almost 30 years, I decided to think about this. I wanted to find out that Tikhonov suggested a correct reformulation. for the incorrect form. And I discovered that he didn't. He suggested some reformulation, but he did not prove the correctness of his formulation. He did not do that. He proved only that his solution exists and will be. And so I start thinking about, is it true, first of all? If it is true, is it possible to prove that this reformulation is a correct problem? I may tell you right now that I've got a positive answer. So this is indeed the correct problem. And so that's what I found out. Proved, and also then I was thinking about possible generalizations. So that's what I'm going to share with you. So Tikhonov proved existence and the universe. About existence, it's so trivial that anybody can prove it using compactness arguments. Here we work in finite dimensional spaces. Fortunately, we can use compactness. The ball is compact if the space is finite dimension. The uniqueness is not true. Uniqueness is not. Now, let us consider three sets. And zero is exactly the set of all Tikhonov solutions. So now we already know that it is not empty, because Tikhonov solutions certainly exists. And zero, all Tikhonov solutions. And one is a set of vectors where the residual is equal exactly. So instead of inequality, we have. And here we have. And then two is most. And two is the set of vectors. Is this the correction or two? Three sets. And the theorem is that this three sets coincide. In fact, they are equal. So, the sets were introduced by Tikhonov, by the way, these three sets. But Tikhonov used only the Euclidean one of the minus. So my first question was about the possible generalization concerning the norms. Could we use different norms? We all know that in modern application of linear algebra, some other norms are very interesting. Rather than just Euclidean. Actually, here we have three types of norms. First is the norm for matrices, then the norm in the solution space, and the norm in the right-hand side space. Three norms. They should be related. First of all, we should assume compatibility. It means just that this is equal. So, these three norms must be compatible in this sense. But what I suggest to have something to it. It's not enough to me. I'd like to suggest a little bit more. Then compatibility, I call it supercompatibility. What supercompatibility means? For any zero vector space, there exists a matrix such that here we have the equivalent. So if we choose arbitrary x and y, then we assume that we can find the matrix A, providing us with this equation. I call this supercompatibility. So we assume this, more work to this. Do we have many supercompatible moons? The answer is yes, we have many. Theory. Any operator moon generated by any vector nonce is supercompatible. Any operator. It means that the famous spectrum of moon is supercompatible. Well, then the shoulder norms are super complex. Frobenius norm is not an operator, you know. But Frobenius norm is also super complex. So there are norms that are not operator norms that are also super complex. This is not, is it a simple theorem or not? My answer is the following. This theorem is the same simple as Hahn-Banach theory. So it's almost equivalent to Hahn-Banach theory. And it can be quite easily proved using Hahn-Banach. So this is the first result, but now let's go further. Now, the basic assumption will be the supercompatibility of norms, and we try to understand when, while using supercompatible norms, we have these three sets and N0 and 1 and 2, why these three sets are equal. Okay, first, let's begin with N0 and N1. This varies. This varies. Look, assume that Z is a Tikhonov solution. Can it be so that here we have strict inequality? If we have here strict inequality, then let's consider X. Multiply Z by 1 minus small epsilon. Of course, X has a smaller norm than Z. And this is contradiction. This is contradiction. Because if we put up A, if we put up A, then we keep the strict inequality. And now it's possible to have a vector, a solution whose norm is less than the norm of Z. So for Tikhonov, for the Tikhonov vector, here we must have equality. Well, this is a very simple argument. But then about matrices. If A minus A0 in the norm is bigger than mu, then of course, Beethoven, if it be top A, then we keep inequality. Now let's choose F in such a way. It is equal to this equation. And now let's find zero in this way. In this way. And then taking F like this, we see that for sufficiently small epsilon, the norm of F is less than mu. Less than mu, then again we have the contradiction. It's a simple fact of the proof. So N0 is equal to N1. N0 is equal to N1. So it's easy, it's really easy. Now, the more difficult part is to understand why N1 equals N2. Here we need supercompatibility of the norms. Again, Z, let's take Z to be a Tikhonov solution. Consider the residual. R0 is the residual for Z. And then I think it's not trivial. Such inequality, this inequality must hold true. Must hold true. So if it is not true, then we get some contradiction. Can we use supercompatibility? By supercompatibility, we take F with such a property, and then the norm of F is this. And for such for some we take alpha as like this, such an alpha is sticking in between 0 and 1, and here the slides show you that we come up with this equation. But maybe details are not so important. Just to give you an impression of how it goes on. But now I may present you the first more general result. Now we may say the following. If the matrix norm is supercompatible with the vector norms of solution in the right-hand side spaces, and if the solution space norm is strongly convex, one more assumption, then Tikhonov solution is unique. So we have a whole class of possible norms where we can say that claim that the Tikhonov solution is unique. This is the explanation. Denoted by mu, the norm of Tikhonov solution Z. The mu is just the norm of Z. And then let's consider rho in this way. Let's consider the rho, or generalized rho, what's called generalized. Then G is G is the vector that minimizes the norm. It's because the pattern 2 coincides with the 0. So we can minimize on N2, we minimize the norm on N2. Yeah. But it's obvious that we, instead of equation here, we may easily put inequality. So we can minimize the norm of X over all vectors in this generalized ball. But now, observe that this generalized ball is convex. This is a convex. Yes. And so we consider the best approximation element on the closed convex set. If the norm is strongly convex, we have uniqueness. We can use this. So now we have a result a bit more general that that was obtained by Tikhonov. But it's still about uniqueness. Now we can get to the correctness. correctness is somewhat an enterprise. We start, we define this function, let's call it Tikhonov function of rho. So for this generalized ball, we minimize the norm of the vector. And this is F of rho. The first observation is that Tikhonov function is this function, is continuous and strictly monotonically decreases on this interval. on this interval. Oh, of course, a zero, it is just the minimum possible residual for the given individual system, it can be less. And the upper point is just the norm of the right hand side. When we move to the right, here we have just zero. So behavior like this. So this is how a chicken function behaves. The proof, well, first we prove the continuity on the right. Continuity on the right is more or less straightforward here. We use compactness, the possibility to select if we have a sequence of vector in a compact set that we can take a subsequence which is converged. Here, and in a similar way, we can continuity on the right, but with some extra arguments. Okay. So first we prove continuity of the Tikhonov function, but then we prove continuity of the Tikhonov vector. So, and the assumption that on each generalized everyone, there is only one. It follows, it follows from the assumption of we make. But anyway, if we have this single vector of minimal norm, then the vector function, that is Z of rho is the minimal vector. So this function is continuous. It's continuous in rho. So this line show you how this can be proved. We use that this sequence contains convergent subsequences and then prove that every convergent subsequence has the same meaning. And so in the end, we conclude that the sequence converges because it is bound. Now, very close to the main result, we prove continuity in A and B. Prove continuity in A and B, and then there are maybe too many details. And then we come up with the main theorem, which is the continuity of the solution. Same as this, under conditions existence and uniqueness theorem, under the same conditions, the Tikhonov solution X, which is a function of four options, depends continuously on these four options. And this is exactly correctness. So Tikhonov set, even in a bit more general setting, Tikhonov formulation is a correct problem. Is a correct problem. And then we can think how we may solve this correct problem. Okay, schema. How to compute Tikhonov solution? There are two steps. First, we consider this equation. So delta is given, mu is given, function f of rho, this is Tikhonov function. We define it all. So we consider this equation and solve this equation. Solve this equation, find the root. In fact, if we draw a graph, it means that we have one function looking like this, just right, and another function like this. And we need to find the intersection.
So the geometrically it's more or less
clear and becomes a rigorous proof. That the suit depends continuously. As soon as we have the root, we find the minimum non zero. Using raw, we use now raw estimate, raw star. So, two basic things. These are both okay. This is a nonlinear equation. This is a nonlinear equation. This is some optimization problem. Okay, computing F is also some optimization problem. So if you know how to solve this optimization problem, and if you know how to solve this equation, but the equation is not a problem. Even not, it's not a big problem. So the optimization problems are the main thing, of course. And then we can compute different solution. If the norm is Frobenius, if norms are Frobenius norm, then these problems are quadratic programming. Quadratic programming problems. For more sophisticated norms, for some Gunter norms, it becomes more. More difficult, but anyway, it is convex problem. If we have convex problem problems, so we can use, we can really use different norms if need be. Now, a remark that moves us a bit away from the main line. If we assume additionally that our individual system A0, if it is consistent, if we assume that it is consistent, then if we tend delta to zero, the Tikhonov solution will converge to the normal pseudo solution. It means that we may consider this approach as a two-parametric regularization. And probably Tikhonov looked at this exactly. Maybe he did not think. I saw that he said, maybe he didn't think about reformulation, but he looked at the, what he set it as a regularization method is two-parametric. Maybe, I can guess it. What he was thinking about. Now some concluding. Oh, I'm perfectly, even before time. Some concluding remarks. How restrictive is the demand on the class of systems to contain at least output systems? By the way, I think that the idea to require that the class contains some consistencies is crucial. Maybe this is how to say it. A little bit of genius is in this. For example, we may consider all these things the different way. Okay, we have a ball of systems equivalent by the accuracy. We have the neighborhood of systems. Okay, for every system, we may compute the unique normal pseudo solution. A very straightforward way to say, okay, let's take the minimal length Swinger solution. Minimal length normal Swinger solution. It will be something. But this something is different from Tikhonov solution. It is really different from Tikhonov solution. So the assumption that the class system contains compatible, consistent systems is really important. Is really important. So the vectors are chosen from vectors that are classic solutions. Okay, how restrictive is this requirement? If M does not exceed N, it's not a restriction of M. For example, let M be equal to N. So we have a square matrix. But we know that in whatever small vicinity of a square matrix, we may have a non-singular one. So we certainly have consistency. So it's not a restriction. It becomes a restriction when M is larger. So this case needs some sort. I have some ideas there. So one kind of natural suggestions may be to enlarge by zero, by zeros. So we have some matrix A zero, but we enlarge it. We take more columns to obtain a square matrix. But then this larger system, larger class, the class of larger system will contain a consistent system when we apply the theory that we have, we define the Tikhonov solution. But then from the Tikhonov solution, we may take just first elements and say that this will be the generalized Tikhonov solution for the overdetermined. Of the overdetermined system, or this is a possible way out. Yes. Now, I'd like to emphasize once more, considering consistent systems seems crucial. Seems crucial in this theory. But now, a natural question that I had part of my life, I worked with very nicely structured matrices. Not only me, Chopin's matrices, for example. So, but it means that we have, when we consider matrices, we have some equations to which the elements satisfy. So we have some structure. And I was thinking if it is possible to make some theory of the same kind or in this situation. And the answer is not clear. The answer is not clear. It is not clear because of the technology used in the proof. The technology used in all proofs is take a perturbation of rank one. We all know that if you consider topless matrices, that a matrix of rank one is topless. It is a Selden field. Mm-hmm. So we may get out from the class. So we have to reconsider the techniques of it. Whether it is possible or not, I don't know. Even more simple things, symmetry, for instance. I still believe that for symmetry assumption, it is possible to do something. But also with the symmetry, rank one matrix, at least rank two is necessary.
But probably for symmetry, this Tikhonov solution can be generalized. Probably. Anyway, if you want to talk about sparsity, Topol, Suhankin, or like that structure, we have a problem. We have a problem here. So no, it is not straightforward. And now, what I still think, people use method of regularization every day in many places, and they would not stop. My point is that when we solve an ill-posed problem, it is still important for a mathematician. It is important to understand what you are doing. I believe problems with physical meaning are not incorrect. They are ill-posed only by one reason. We look at just a part of the problem. We don't see the whole problem. And the method of regularization provides us with some technology to incorporate some a priori information in quite a general way. But anyway, it would be interesting to write down explicitly the problem that we solve. So it is an interesting situation. We don't write down the problem, but this problem probably appears during the method. During the method of regularization, we apply the method, we obtain some solution, but we do not produce the problem that we solved. And my point of view, that it may be interesting to put some efforts into this and in some general setting of the situations where the general method of regularization is applied, to prove that it's possible to write down a correct setting, which can be solved by regularization methods, kind of that. So that's why I say that my talk is a bit philosophical. Maybe consider it as a bit philosophical, but probably I told you everything I wanted to tell. Thank you so much for your kind attention.
So maybe I ask a simple question. So of course, for us doing this kind of solving this kind of impulse problem, for example, from certain point of view, like so we usually talk about Tikhonov. When we talk about Tikhonov, we use the first thing that you mentioned, that we add the alpha and then identity, right? So now you are saying that, okay, so we can also solve it without something like that, right? So this step will be looked at easier. So do you think that,
I don't think that it is easier.
It is easier, not easier. So,
But I think about the difference here. I think that it might be possible. We use regularization not only in the cases when our problem is indeed correct. It may be just very important. Maybe condition number is very large.
Yeah.
We also use it. But in this case, we solve a correct problem.
Mm-hmm.
Well, but if we have a really correct problem, like a normal pseudo solution, that maybe in some cases it's possible to write down the correct setting that substitute the regions.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe it would be possible to prove that the method of regularization really solves the correct setting.
Mm-hmm.
It's a most safe for ground.
Mm-hmm.
That is my point. But I don't think that technologically this might be Not fast. Maybe not. But another thing, here is the setting I presented to you. It's possible to use different modes.
Yeah.
Different modes. Maybe it is of some interest. But what I wanted to see at some end, some theory, some general theorem that when you apply the method of regularization according to the theory, then in those cases it's possible to write down the correct setting beforehand, before you apply the method, and then prove that you really solve the correct problem that substitutes the original one. So it's a philosophical thing. I believe it is true, but not in all cases is it.
Any other questions?
Because at the beginning, you have an example, very simple example, you demonstrate, say, matrix A is an epsilon, and there's a problem on the solution that can be posed. But in your talking about this new set, I mean, the formula, the technical solution, based on the this perturbation of A and B, but how the this kind of so called new conditions of the matrix A appear in your in the concept? I try to take out one, take out that. You understand my maybe my question is not formulated very well. But
yeah.
Some seems to be your mu, and somehow the mu is control the
yes,
the,
we have some range. Yeah, we have in that primitive example.
Yeah,
but also it satisfies the issue. And if we fix the new delta, if we fix the delta, then we can find it.
So in this case, if you add to your one by one example, the new will be very large. And because your elevation.
Yeah, it should begin.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, it should begin.
So I somehow your ill condition is
So I hope that the solution is continuous. Did not look at the derivatives. How it changes with the new. It's another step. Maybe here. Yes.
Okay. Any other questions? No, then Eugene will be here until December the 4th. So if you have any questions, you can ask it. Okay. Okay, so thank you very much, Eugene.